Welcome to Spiritual Spectrum. My name is Marvin Gowron, and I'll be your host for the next hour. Our country was founded on a heritage of religious freedom, and as a result, unlike any other place on earth, America is a land where every religious group is welcome, regardless of whether it may be large, well-established, or perhaps only small and recently emerging on the religious scene. Our purpose on Spiritual Spectrum is to explore the new and emerging trends in American religion. Each of our shows will feature a different religious group, and our focus will be on the personal spiritual experience of our guests. What we try to do is look at the elements in their particular tradition which have been most important, most meaningful in their personal spiritual experience. Our guests on this particular show are all four of them members of the Church of Religious Science. And I'd like to turn now to our guests and ask them a little bit. I'll introduce them and ask them each to say a little bit about how they first encountered religious science, their initial reactions, how they became slowly but surely involved in the Church of Religious Science. Our first guest is Patty Lucas. Patty, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And perhaps you could tell us just a little bit about when you first encountered the church and your initial reactions and how you got into it.
Well, it was approximately 15 years ago. I had just experienced an incredible life change type situation, and a friend invited me to go over to the Religious Science Church. I had never been. In fact, I had never really heard much about religious science. And I went, and I've been there ever since. And I guess as a child, I used to have a lot of questions about my spirituality, a lot of questions a lot of people couldn't answer for me. And I walked in those doors, and it was just kind of like coming home for me, because gradually those questions have been answered. There's always another question, which is good. But I feel I really have expanded and grown a lot, and it just has meant everything to me.
So your initial reaction right at the start was quite favorable.
It was. I felt real accepted there. I felt a sense of, I didn't feel any judgments, mm-hmm. You know. I just felt really accepted and loved.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went back and immediately enrolled in some of the classes and began to learn the philosophy a little bit more.
Were your views a little bit at variance from those you found there, or were they pretty much exactly fairly parallel with what you found?
Well, they were pretty much parallel mm-hmm. from what I had been thinking even as a kid. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, I was with a group of people, I felt like minds, you know, who were thinking the thoughts that at times I thought no one else couldn't possibly be thinking.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's been really, really good. So it has been really favorable.
Oh, neat.
Really good.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
We'll take a look a little later on, a little more at the content of what some of the teachings of religious science are, and I'll appreciate your thoughts then.
Okay.
Our next guest is Wallace Duke, and Wallace, you're a minister at which church now?
It's the New Life Church of Religious Science.
Uh-huh. In which part of the city, which part of Denver?
It's in Denver. It's northeast Denver.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Could you share a little bit with us about how you first ran into religious science and your initial reactions and sort of how it went from there?
Well, I like the way you put that, how I ran into religious science. I was doing a lot of running, trying to find a way to feel comfortable in my life. Answers to spiritual questions, answers to what made things work and how did things tick and where did I fit in this whole scheme of things. And much of what Patty has said was my experience, that I was introduced to the church through friends, as you know most people have been, and just began to get involved, and I found that the philosophy, the teachings, explain things to me that I had been exploring. Prior to religious science, I was involved in studying various Eastern philosophies, mm-hmm. none of them in depth, but getting things from each of them. And religious science seemed to bring a lot of all that together for me
mm-hmm.
and make it practical and useful for daily living.
So it offered sort of a synthesizing overall framework
yeah.
for a lot of the things that you had found.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Great. Our third guest is Mary Ann Trifaro. Am I pronouncing it correctly?
Mm-hmm, correctly.
And Mary Ann, you're also a minister with the church here locally in Denver? Or?
Yes, it's in Aurora,
uh-huh.
And it's called the Cherry Creek Church of Religious Science.
Okay. Can you tell us a little bit of your history, how you first encountered mm-hmm. religious science?
I wasn't brought to a church immediately. I was given a book to read in metaphysics, and I read the book. A friend of mine told me that she thought I was very negative in my approach to living, and I couldn't understand where she was coming from because I thought I was so kind and I would do everything for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
And I think she was trying to point that out, was that I didn't have any confidence in myself. And so I read a book on metaphysics and learning more about the philosophy, and then I started going to one of the religious science churches
mm-hmm.
and got very intrigued by the philosophy and began classes, and that was back in 76, and so I've been taking classes and kept taking them until there weren't any more to take.
So that was about 10 years ago when you first encountered
mm-hmm.
it, and
mm-hmm.
Did you participate as just sort of a regular member for how long, and then decided to go into the ministry? And how did that go?
Well, immediately, the first Sunday I showed up at church, they were announcing classes, so I immediately enrolled in classes. So
mm-hmm.
I became a student right away.
Uh-huh.
And then, and part of the church, I got involved in everything from teaching the Sunday school to selling books at the bookstore to
mm-hmm.
ushering, and eventually I started doing the announcements at the Sunday service, and I just kept taking on more and more responsibility and enjoying it so much more. And then back in 82 I decided that I would go into the ministry
mm-hmm.
and complete the last few years.
So you got ministry training, and
mm-hmm.
then how does it work? Do they just give you a church, or do they say, we need a church in this area? Would you be willing to start something going? How did that happen?
Well, the way it happens is, after you complete your school of ministry, your ministerial training,
mm-hmm.
you have to be employed by a church. A church has to engage you in
mm-hmm.
before you're actually a minister, before that's activated. So there is a newsletter that goes out to all the potential ministers.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me. And this is sent out from our headquarters office in Los Angeles to those that are interested, and letting them know what churches are looking for ministers. And so then at that time you can send a tape of one of your talks along with your resume to the different churches. And they have a selection committee,
mm-hmm.
and they narrow it down. They could get as many as 30 people who are interested in that particular church,
mm-hmm.
and then they narrow it down, and then they invite, say, three or four to the church
to do a
sermon and maybe do some counseling or do a workshop
mm-hmm.
so that they can get to know you, and
mm-hmm.
then from there they make their selection.
Pretty orderly kind of process.
Yeah, and it takes a while. Yeah.
Thank you.
our
last guest is Dr. Fred Vogt, and Fred, I guess, has been with religious science probably quite a bit longer than most of the rest of the other three of our guests. In fact, Fred is the president of the Church of Religious Science,
yeah.
which comprises about how many churches are there, actual?
Oh,
roughly.
I think we only have around 50 or 60, no, 150 churches.
About 150 churches.
Yeah.
And it's headquartered largely in Southern California, but there are churches in different locations.
Yeah, our headquarters are in Los Angeles,
mm-hmm.
Where it all started, really. Mm-hmm. And we have slowly moved across the country. The biggest concentration still is in Southern California.
Southern California. Can you tell us a little bit about how you first encountered the teachings of religious science, and just sort of a little history of your involvement?
Well, I had been a minister. I'd graduated seminary, went out in the ministry in another denomination, and after about 15 years, I discovered this is not working for me.
Mm-hmm.
So, big trauma, I left the ministry, never did think I'd ever do that again. And to cut out a lot of things, I was a West Coast sales manager for a company, and one of my salesmen asked me if I ever thought of going to church, and I said, well, no, I don't think so anymore. And he said, well, if you ever do, try the Church of Religious Science. So I had no intention of going, but here, one Sunday morning, I got up and I wanted to go to church so bad. And I thought about what he said, so I went over there. Brand new church, half a mile, I was in Arcadia, California at the time. And it was wonderful. I just sat down and it was great. Great long pews, and everything was new. I went about halfway down, way in the middle. At that time, I thought women had no place in the pulpit, you see. So guess what happened? Out came a lady in a pink robe. And I thought, oh, God, no, I've done it. But I was too embarrassed to get up and leave right away, you see. And I believed everything that lady said. I left there with a stack of books this high. I enrolled in every kind of class they could offer and just dived right in.
Mm-hmm. And it's sort of gone that way ever since.
Yeah.
Why don't I just sort of throw it open and ask any of you that feel moved to, might you share a little bit with us about what the main teachings, the main tenets, principles in religious science are? Obviously, all of you, upon first encountering them, were immediately and deeply attracted. What are the main tenets in your mind of religious science?
Let me start that one off.
Please.
I think basically the thing that attracted me was the teaching of oneness. Mm-hmm. One life. There is no separation. And that bleeds out into all kinds of parts of your life, areas of your life. There's a cohesiveness about it. We are one with each other because we are one with God. There's not a God way up there keeping notes. Mm-hmm. But that God lives within me. And that life that I live is that life. And I can learn then, instead of having a God to plead with, I can learn to commune from deep within inside myself and find the guidance and everything that I need and the help and the strength. And then, of course, I feel at one with everyone else. Even the people I didn't like, I discovered I am one with those people. We are the same life. And it makes a tremendous difference in your own self-concept, your own sense of self-worth. There is no inferior nor superior. We are all that and doing with it what we can and what we find out to do.
Hmm. That's interesting. I think, Wallace, you mentioned that you had been looking at some Eastern concepts.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds similar to some Hindu concepts
very
that I'm familiar with, the oneness of all reality.
The thing that popped out at me when I first got involved with religious science was the idea that you could change your thinking and change your experience. That if you wanted to be healthy, you'd change the way you thought about your body, mm-hmm. and you'd be more healthy. And those kinds of idea, for one, was the one that when I was first involved, 21 years old, I mean, that was a real profound, meaningful idea. It still is. It's taken on a greater meaning as time has gone by in practicing that idea and practicing that aspect of our philosophy. And what happens, it's not that what we teach is strictly change your thinking, change your life, but that coupled with the idea of oneness mm-hmm. strengthens the realization of both.
Let me ask you, how do you change your thinking? Are there specific methods and techniques that religious science teaches in order to accomplish that change of thinking and of habit? Or is it more just that's a goal and people sort of address it in their own individual ways?
Well, I think every religion has a way of change. You know, the whole thing is to do something so you have a relationship with God.
Mm-hmm.
And what we teach basically is affirmations, how to use affirmations and how to pray. And in prayer we call treatment, spiritual mind treatment.
Mm-hmm.
But a synonym for that is prayer. But we don't use the term prayer in a traditional sense. We're not pleading or asking or supplicating ourselves to God, trying to get God to do something for us.
How is prayer or treatment, as you call it, as I guess religious science calls it, how is it different from the common understanding of prayer? What's the process of treatment? I've heard you use it in our discussions mm-hmm. before the show. I've heard you use it a fair amount. What is treatment, and how is it different from prayer? How is it similar?
Well, I can start with that, mm-hmm. and then if you want to add to that. Positive prayer, or treatment, as we call it, is realizing again, as Dr. Fred said, that presence of God is within us. We're not separate from. It's not this figure sitting on a throne far off, away from us. It's a presence that's within us.
Let me ask just a quick clarifying mm-hmm. question. Is it the case that religious science teaches that God is us, in fact, we are God, or is it just that God is close and intimate and internal? But distinction I'm raising?
Our very life. There's only one life. Ernest Holmes said, who was our founder, Ernest Holmes said, there's one life. That life is God. Mm-hmm. That life is perfect. And that life is my life now. So the very life, well, science says, everything, you boil it down basically, you'll come to that basic element, they call it energy or whatever, mm-hmm. that we all really are made of the very same stuff. And of course, we see it as a lot more than just energy. You know, we see intelligence and so on in that. But that's what we are. We don't go around saying, I'm God, I'm God. Mm-hmm. But we do know that the whatever we are is the God stuff of the universe. Changes okay. your self-concept tremendously, and not to egotism, but to a deep awareness of the importance of every individual and every form of life.
Okay, I should apologize. Mm-hmm. I sort of interrupted you. You were talking about treatment, mm-hmm. and you were talking mm-hmm. about God's presence within.
Right. So just to continue, mm-hmm. Again, what we were saying is that the presence of God is within us. We are within God, and God is within us. There's no separation at mm-hmm. all. It's like a drop of water in an ocean. Mm-hmm. You know, it's part of it, and it has all the same aspects of it. So treatment is a five-step process. And the first step is recognizing the truth about the fact that life is one. What I've just been saying, or what we've just been saying, is that there's oneness, that this mm-hmm. life, this spirit, this infinite intelligence, this love is everywhere within life. There's no place that it's not.
So the principle of recognizing that unity.
Mm-hmm. That's the first step. And the second step, then, is recognizing, since that's true, since there's no place that God is not, mm-hmm. then this presence must be everywhere, and if it's everywhere, it must be within me. So therefore, I can open up to receiving and using these attributes of God, be it in the form of love or joy or peace or prosperity or health or happiness, mm-hmm. in any form. I can then begin to allow these attributes to express through me as me. Mm-hmm. So that's the second step, is unifying with this presence. Mm-hmm. And then the third step is recognizing that since the first two are so, then anything that will enhance my spiritual growth, that doesn't harm anyone or hurt anyone, but anything that can assist me to experiencing life fuller, then is good. And that is something that it is the pleasure of God to give me the kingdom. Mm-hmm. In other words, I can expand my awareness or expand my experiences in life by experiencing more of the joy and the life and the truth, etc.
Okay, so that's the third step.
That's the third step. And then the fourth and the fifth kind of run together, and mm-hmm. that's thanksgiving and release. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of, again, the difference between treatment and traditional prayer is that sometimes we feel that in the traditional form we might have to beg. We might have to say, oh, please, God, you know, if you do this for me, I'll never do that again, type mm-hmm. thing. So we get away from that, and we just realize that just this creative process of being one with God allows us to experience these attributes, and we then give thanks for it as if it's already accepted in our reality, mm-hmm. and then we let it go. Release is letting it go.
So it sounds like it's more a recognition, excuse me, an acknowledgement of what is there. Rather than asking for something, it's more a process of discovering what's really there.
Exactly.
In its
mm-hmm.
fullness.
Exactly.
Okay. Do you, all of you have, or any of you that care to address this, have a vivid sense of God's presence within? I mean, what's the experience like for you? The sense of God's presence within and that sense of relationship.
Hmm.
Any experiences? Mm-hmm. We've got a couple of minutes before we take our first break, but any experiences? Patty, yeah, please.
Well, it's difficult to explain in words many times a God experience, mm-hmm. To be able to define it out. But for me, it's just been a sense of assurance, not assurance that has separated me from my fellow men, say, mm-hmm. by any type of egotistic way, like, well, I, you know, have this good feeling. But it's a universal good feeling of just peace and that assurance, and perhaps I could say gratitude and love. Just a point of total acceptance of myself and everyone and everything.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any other thoughts before we move up to our break here on what that inner contact?
I'd like to just share that experience for me is it's a sense of power. Mm-hmm. And not a kind of power that I can control people or things. It's just it's like a power that just surges, is a surging type power. So this is the way I experience it. And when I'm in tune, let's mm-hmm. say, or in alignment, or aware of my true self, which is my God self, I sense that power. And with that power, all things are possible. And that's living in the presence of God for me.
Does that power have a quality of love associated with it?
Of course.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's the very nature of it, really.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
almost mm-hmm. of the essence.
Mm-hmm. It's the power to look beyond someone screaming at you and to know that there's love behind that sound.
Right.
That what they really want to do is love you.
And be loved.
Yeah, and mm-hmm. be loved. And that power is to love them even while that's taking place.
Mm-hmm. You see? That's a nice note on which to take our break. We'll be back in about a minute for a little more conversation with our guests who are members of the Church of Religious Science on Spiritual Spectrum. Stay tuned.
YWCA, it takes all kinds to make a world. YWCA, it takes all kinds to make a world. YWCA, it takes all kinds, it takes you.
Welcome back to Spiritual Spectrum. We've been having some very enjoyable discussion with our guests who are members of the Church of Religious Science. We're going to take a few minutes now and listen to some questions on the part of our audience members, the audience here in our studios, many of whom are also participants in the Church of Religious Science. So let's go now to our first question on the part of an audience member for our panel.
Is there sin in religious science?
Okay. There's a good, succinct question. Is there sin in religious science? Anyone?
I'll address that. In religious science, we do not accept the idea of sin as most traditional churches have in the past. We interpret sin as miseducation as far as our thinking, missing the mark, or just a mistake. And so we don't establish that as any type of doctrine or any type of rule in which people have to go by and repent of. And so we recognize the allness and the goodness of God.
There's a question related to that. Mm-hmm. There's a distinction between someone making a mistake, mm-hmm. drifting, as it were, spiritually, and someone who has a pretty clear sense of something being right, and ignoring it and pushing it away, which is a difference. Does religious science make that distinction much, and how does a person sort of get over that situation where they struggle with something that they know is not quite right and they've grappled with it? What does religious science say about how to resolve that kind of a situation? How do we go about resolving that kind of struggle?
There's really not... There's no degrees. Mm-hmm. That presupposes that there's a degree of sin or there's a degree of mistake. Mm-hmm. Mistake, you say the wrong thing, and that's forgivable. But if you purposely run into somebody's car, that's not forgivable. There's no degree because everything has a consequence. Mm-hmm. But we believe in consequences, whereas the idea of sin has to do with a person's salvation, whether or not they're going to be punished and what the degree of the punishment will be. We don't believe in a punishment, but a consequence. That for everything that we believe, everything that we teach, everything that we say, do, feel, or express in any way has a consequence because it sets the stage for something else to take place in our life. It goes back to the idea of change your thinking, change your life.
Yeah, Fred.
He alluded to it, this business of cause and effect.
Mm-hmm.
And we are or sowing and reaping. Jesus talked about mm-hmm. what you sow, you're going to reap.
Or in the Eastern traditions, the karma, law of karma.
Karma. Mm-hmm. And my secretary said, yesterday, my karma ran over your dogma. Or I thought that was kind of good.
Right.
But it is true. We sow by what we think and what we say and what we do. And as we sow those, there is an inevitable consequence to that action, a reaction to the action. What you sow, you're going to get back, sometimes even multiplied. So the thing is, if we're sowing the things we don't want to reap and we realize it, it's like going into your garden and rip out the stuff that you planted into your consciousness and replant with the kinds of things that you do want to reap. And the word sin comes basically from the word that means to miss the mark, an archery word.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't fall down and weep and mourn and ask to be forgiven if you miss the mark. You haul another arrow out and you pull down again to see if you can hit the mark this time. In that vein, that's the way we look at sin and consequence.
Okay, good. Any other thoughts?
I'll just add to that in saying that life is a learning process, and everything that happens to us, hopefully we'll learn from it. I mean, we're not going to stick our hand on the flame too many times before realizing it hurts and that we need to not do that. And I believe that's how life is for us. We have within us, again, that innate quality of intelligence and love, and it's going to guide us. As a matter of fact, that presence within sometimes might be called intuition. And the word intuition, it means inner teacher.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that guides us. And life, again, is a learning process. So hopefully we learn with each experience.
Okay. Sounds sort of like a fairly gentle approach to the whole question of sin. And basically that it's a learning process, and progressively we move away from it and move toward what is right and real.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Let's go to another question from our audience and see what they would like to ask our panelists.
How can man be equal to God? How can man be a co-creator with what we perceive as God?
Okay. How can man be an equal with God, be a co-creator with God? Any thoughts?
That's a good question.
Any more good questions?
Now we'll go to our next question. Let's stay with that one.
It's there's something that we have to understand that about our religious science is that we don't say that we're equal with God, and we don't say that we are God exclusively. That we are God. That we are all of God. God is much greater. All that the universe is much greater than we are as an individual. We are an individual part of God. We're an individual expression of God. And yes, we are co-creators with God, and what God is always creating is this life. And as we participate in this life, we're creating our own experience of it. So we are co-creating with God this life and its experience and its expression.
Mm-hmm. Let me throw out a thought here, which I think has tendrils sort of connected to a number of things we've touched on before, and that is the idea, including what we're just talking about now, that is the idea of God's will and God having a sense of guidance or leading for us and tapping into that and trying to get a sense of what that is and living in conformity with it, in a sense co-creating with God. Is there a sense in religious science of leading, of guidance, of inspiration? What is the mechanism for that happening? How does one more effectively seek guidance or direction from God? Anything about that process that you can say, I'd be interested in.
Well, that reminds me of the other question you asked, is if we have a personal experience of God.
Yeah.
And I feel that in times where I need an answer, some direction in my life, the thing I do is to be quiet. And that always works. I mean, it's be still and let that small voice within you speak.
Mm-hmm.
And it's quieting ourselves from the outside world, allowing ourselves to maybe take a few deep breaths and listening. The presence is within us, and it will express itself. We will have a sense. We have a knowing by being quiet.
Okay. Listening.
Listening. And meditating is a form of listening to that presence.
Good. Any thoughts from your tradition on how to listen more effectively? That's a tricky process, and sometimes it's hard to differentiate what comes from your own mind, what is really higher guidance. Any practical suggestions on how that process happens?
It's a little like, you have to listen a lot. It's like the first time you and I talk on the phone, we have to identify ourselves. But if we're good friends and we're together a lot, after a while, as soon as you say hello, I know who that is. And there's that, if you continue to do this, granted, there are times when you don't know for sure. But as you continue to do this and continue to get comfortable and more and more sensitive, the difference becomes pretty obvious most of the time. And you can tell when you're listening to yourself, your little self, your little human outer self, or listening to other people's opinions, or whether there is a truth. Something solid seems to happen, and you know that inner voice.
I'm reminded of what Wallace was saying, that sense of power. There's a sense of almost hooking up to a circuitry that's much larger than your own, and having a sense of reality that is very strong in relation to some sense of guidance that you're getting.
I've always said that the only large mistakes I've made in my ministry is when I have not listened to what I say, I listen to my gut. When I listen to that inner something, that inner guidance, I don't make very many big mistakes. But if I try to run with my head alone, that's when I run myself off into problems that I can't handle anymore, and I've got to back up.
Okay. Any other thoughts on that question of inner leading, inner guidance, inner relationship with God, things that come from that relationship?
The idea for me is trust. We have to be willing to trust what we're hearing. In reality, what's coming through is only, we believe that since all is one, in oneness, that there is one mind. Now, mind and brain are not the same. Brain is a physical
organ,
computer of sorts. Thank you, Fred. And what's happening is we have to trust what we're hearing, because our individual mind, which is not separate from the one mind, but like drops of water, have the same essence. What we hear is coming through in ways that we can understand. So it may sound like something that's very plain and very common, but if we're not trusting that, we'll look for something that has to be extraordinary, rather than something natural and common sense.
So sometimes that inspiration comes in ways that sort of clothed and couched in ways that are quite normal and natural. Okay.
It can be a thought that comes out of the blue. Sometimes we're doing something mundane like vacuuming, and all of a sudden you have a thought or an idea. Whatever that is, that just kind of spurs you on to knowing.
I think also there's a bit of a value. There's a value-laden quality to that inspiration. You sense a deeper value to it, a spiritual value to it. Interesting.
Vacuum, do you?
No.
That's one of the techniques in religious sciences, to vacuum.
Yeah.
Why, yes.
New
technique. For inspiration.
Right. In order to get inspiration. Keep vacuuming. I can see
vacuum up
entire congregations vacuuming the church, right?
That's how we get volunteers.
Right. Right. Actually, I've heard people say that getting inspiration can be upstepped substantially when you're engaged in service.
Exactly.
That when you're serving, there are connections made that allow you to get inspiration in new ways. Let's go now again to our audience and take one last question for our panel.
Do you believe in life after death?
Now there's a question. We've touched on this tangentially a little bit with sin and salvation, but what are religious sciences' thoughts about life after death? And we'll take a few short comments. We're coming up to a break again, and then we'll probably continue this after the break. But any thoughts? Life after death?
Yes. We believe in the continuum of life, and that when this life expression, Dr. Fred so beautifully in his memorial or funeral services usually explains it, like this evening I will take this suit off, mm-hmm. and I no longer will have this appearance. But what makes up Patty, what is the essence of Patty, moves on, moves forward. So we understand life after the death of this expression is just a continuum, just kind of like moving onto a new level of awareness.
So there's something that is of the essence,
yes.
of Patty.
Right.
I think what many traditions term the soul.
The soul, the living soul.
Is that a relevant term in religious science?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That when the body dies, the soul in some form goes on.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe we can talk a little bit more about that process of going on and maybe a little more any thoughts you might have on what happens in the next life after we come back from our break. So we'll take a break and then go on to the next segment of our show, as it were. Stay with us. We'll be back with Spiritual Spectrum and our guests in just 1 minute.
When famine strikes, Americans move quickly to share our abundant food supply, but it's time to share something more lasting, technical know-how that will enable people to meet their own basic needs. Meals for Millions is on that path, planting the seeds for permanent solutions to world hunger, helping people in Africa, Asia, Latin America, and our own Southwest free themselves from life-threatening poverty. In my garden, I choose seeds, fertilizers, and growing techniques that make me quite a food producer. Family by family, community by community, Meals for Millions is teaching people gardening, animal raising, fish farming, and other techniques that will empower them to break free of the need for assistance. The logic is simple. Give me a fish, I eat today. Teach me to fish, I eat every day. Find out how we bring self-help to a hungry world. Write Meals for Millions. Isn't it time?
Welcome back to Spiritual Spectrum. Our guests on this show are all practitioners. Maybe that's not quite the right term. We'll maybe look at that. But in any case, members, participants in the Church of Religious Science. And we were talking just before our break about the nature of afterlife and recognizing that there is a soul, something qualitatively that goes on after this physical body dies. And let me ask any of the four of you your thoughts on what the nature of afterlife is. Do we have experience? Are we here? Do we come back here? Do we go somewhere else? Does religious science get at all explicit about the nature of the afterlife?
Not really, because nobody knows for sure. Our idea,
not even in religious science?
Well, maybe with us, but nobody else for sure. But we have, and that's left a little free, except this, that we do thoroughly accept that the one thing we cannot do is dissipate and disappear and cease to be, because we are made of the one thing that cannot die, and that's life, or God. So we must, we feel, must persist. And so we call it a transition, moving from this plane to the next plane of experience. I often think of it as graduation.
Mm-hmm.
You get promoted from this grade to the next one, whatever it might be.
Do we retain our individuality?
Oh, I think we must. Otherwise, we're nothing.
Mm-hmm.
We'd be like throwing the drop of water back into the ocean. You know, you're lost. And the purpose of life is to express itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so it needs individual or individualized expressions, some kind of form in which to express.
This jumps a little bit, but is there a sense in religious science that God is a personal God? You mentioned individuality and expression. And is God, I mean, God obviously is much larger than anything we represent, but is God also personal? Can one have a personal relationship?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yes,
and that's very precious, very important. That's mm-hmm. what undergirds the whole thing. That's what gives us a sense of faith. And it is done unto you as you believe. And if we don't have a sense of that oneness, that personal oneness, that spirit, that presence is there, we're kind of shooting in the dark, you know. We're still running on our little human stuff that didn't work for us before.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
When you talk about the personalness of God...
Wallace, let me interrupt you just for a second. We'll return to your thought. I just want to say one thing, and I forgot to mention it after we came back from the break, and that is if any of our viewers are interested in writing us, getting in touch with us a little later toward the end of the program, we're going to have an address and a telephone number that you can reach us here on the show if you have questions, either about Spiritual Spectrum, the show itself, or about Religious Science. We can put you in touch with the churches in the area. So if you're interested, get a piece of paper and a pencil, and we'll get to that at the end of the show. I just wanted to let you know, give you a little bit of warning. Let's go back now to Wallace and your thought about the personality of God.
Well, not personality of God, personalness. Uh-huh. The personalness of God is my own personal relationship with God. That's how I see it. Mm-hmm. And in terms of what Patty said earlier about God being to her, or the presence of God being peace, assurance, gratitude, and love, and what I said about the presence of God being a sense of power, well, that's the personalness of God. It's our personal way that we perceive that thing we call God, that thing we call spirit, that thing we call truth.
Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like a friendship in the sense that you have a friend, that friend has reality as a person, but you as a person have your personal sense of them, which is special and unique. Does that relate to what you're saying?
Not really.
Okay.
That's good.
Well,
but that's good.
Let's just say I'm coming entirely from out of left field, but occasionally I do that.
Oh. Let me take a moment, may I?
Sure.
To explain it the way it was explained to me one time that helped a lot. When I first got into this, we talked about the law. There is a law of mind, mm-hmm. a creative law, mm-hmm. that sowing and reaping, that cause and effect, and so on. And I said to one of the leaders of the church, I miss the presence. I used to drive along in the car, and I thought God rode right with me, and we could hold a conversation. And it was very wonderful to me and very precious, and I miss that out of this. Mm-hmm. I believe everything about it, but that, to me, I miss. And he said, Fred, try this. Try, you had God over here, try moving God here. Mm-hmm. And your conversation is within.
Internal dialogue.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that helped me tremendously and made a great, great difference in that personal relationship that I really needed so much.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let me shift a little bit here and touch on something we've touched on peripherally. We mentioned treatment, we mentioned some of the methods. I want to ask you, what are some of the things that either happen at a Religious Science service or that happen at other activities at the Church of Religious Science? What do ministers do? There's also a distinction between, is it a practitioner and a minister? Am I correct in that?
Mm-hmm.
What does a practitioner do? What does a minister do? What are some of the functions and activities that actually go on?
Okay.
Maybe we'll start with the difference between a practitioner and a minister and what a practitioner does. Minister, I think, is more commonly understood what a minister does.
Okay, I'll address that. A practitioner is trained in the art of treatment, if we could call that an art.
Mm-hmm.
The consciousness of that treatment work, to aid and assist people in prayer work, known as a spiritual counselor for the church that works strictly with the prayer work and aiding people to develop their consciousness of oneness and to bring forth that desire result of that peace, that power, that God power expressing in their lives. And I'd like to mention that all ministers are also practitioners. Mm-hmm. And from becoming a practitioner, and we are licensed by the United Church of Religious Science
as a practitioner,
from that point, then you move into the ministry. And I'll let the ministers here explain that.
Just one clarifying question. Practitioners, it sounds like from what you're saying, do essentially personal work, one-to-one work. Do they do small group work as well, or is it just really personal?
Well, they do small group work, but the main emphasis is for them to do spiritual mind healing for individuals. So basically you are working one-to-one with another individual to bring them to that consciousness of oneness.
That's interesting. I'll sort of make an observation there with that sort of follows a pattern in the way that Jesus did his initial work. he encouraged personal ministry. Mm-hmm. And then as things sort of gained momentum, he moved more into, and his apostles moved more into public ministry. And that's an interesting sequence. That's very interesting.
The founder of the Religious Science Church thought of the practitioners as the healing arm of the church. Hmm. And I see it many times as the silent ministry, which is that ministry that is just always in that consciousness of oneness, mm-hmm. and supporting our ministers, mm-hmm. as they support us.
Another interesting distinction is that between pastoral sort of counseling ministry, mm-hmm. and more public kinds of ministry.
Right.
Sounds like that's what the somewhat the division of labor is, mm-hmm. is about. You alluded to the practitioner then moving on to becoming a minister and taking on additional duties and activities. Our three ministers perhaps might comment on what those activities are.
All right, I'll begin. Mm-hmm. I was a practitioner, and then I continued my classes and decided to be a minister. And so in addition to working one-on-one with individuals, I do the classwork. I also teach classes. And also because my church is a small church growing right now, I have the opportunity of doing a lot of the administration as well as the business aspect of running the church. Mm-hmm. And then Sunday services, I do the Sunday sermon or lecture, as we call it. Mm-hmm. And that pretty much keeps me busy throughout the week.
I'll bet.
Yeah.
I'll bet. Okay.
Perhaps I could explain a little bit about, it sounds like you just kind of drift from practitioner to minister. Mm-hmm. We have specific classwork set up for all of our people that want to take it, called Science of Mind, say Science of Mind 1, Science of Mind 2. Mm-hmm. Those are 2 years of study for mm-hmm. anyone. Mm-hmm. To learn this philosophy and how to use it, make it practical in their life. Then if one wants to be a practitioner, when they have done that, when they've concluded those 2 years, then they can take 2 years of what we might call graduate studies, specifically designed to prepare one to be a practitioner, a professional practitioner in the church. Mm-hmm. Now then, if you want to become a minister, you must have gone that far. And then we have five seminaries or schools of ministry scattered throughout the country. And mm-hmm. incidentally, we're going to have one here in Denver starting next fall, I believe. Mm-hmm. But there are 3 years of study there.
Out of curiosity, where are the other five?
Los Angeles, of course, our main school. Mm-hmm. Right? Then there's one in San Jose, California, one in Seattle, one in Florida. Mm-hmm. Is that it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So at that point, they become a formal practitioner.
Yeah. They become a practitioner. They can become that at the local level. Mm-hmm. Then, if they want to become a minister, then they must go to one of the schools, and our curriculum is a 3-year curriculum, after which they graduate, if they do. Mm-hmm. Then it's kind of like the lawyer passes
the bar.
Yeah, well, he has to pass the bar after he graduates.
Right.
We have exams that they must pass after they graduate from ministerial school, mm-hmm. and then when they've completed all that, then they may be licensed as a minister.
Okay, so it's quite a thorough regime that they move through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not something that you just step into and say, oh, I think I'd like to do this today. Mm-hmm. It requires a great deal of dedication. Practitioner is a person that's dedicated their life to practicing spiritual mind treatment, mm-hmm. as their means and method by which they practice healing, by which they assist people in growing spiritually and heal all manner of affairs and problems and situations.
Mm-hmm. So it's really important that the minister be a living example, in a sense, of the principles.
Exactly.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, and yet we live less in a glass house than a traditional minister. Are people recognize that? I was going to say we can get away with more, but I mean, we're not under scrutiny. They allow us to be a human being, mm-hmm. and it's permissible to have a fault or two, and because you're not under judgment.
Except for the president.
Well, the president must have no fault.
No fault. Okay. I had a question related to the attitude, the relationship that religious science has toward other religious groups. Does it feel it is, in some sense, is it better than other religious groups?
No, no.
What is it worse than other religious groups?
No, it's just different from other religious groups.
Just different. Okay.
We have a unique approach to living, a unique philosophy, a unique approach to the Bible, a unique approach to Eastern philosophies, a unique approach to all of them. But we take things from every religion and we use them, because there's truth in every religion. And every Sunday morning we bless every church that endeavors to reveal the truth.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
There's a golden thread that runs through all religions, and in Science of Mind, the process is about self-discovery again, and it's about discovering that presence within and learning from our mistakes and keep growing. And so that's where our freedom comes from, is the fact that we're discovering more and more about our life.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that process of constant spiritual learning.
Mm-hmm.
I could see how that would be pretty deeply related to attitude toward other religious groups, that there's always something to learn from other religious groups and something to respect. I remember the principle being articulated once that every religion can learn from the best of every other religion.
Yes.
And that in a sense we're all striving after many of the same goals. We may articulate them differently, and creedally it might be different, but the essence is very similar.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned when we talked a little bit before the show began that, and we've mentioned a little bit in discussion as well, some of the principles might trace their way back to Eastern principles in Eastern religion. Some of them might trace their way back to more Western traditions, particularly Christianity. What is there in the teachings of Jesus that the Church of Religious Science has, in a sense, drawn from? And you mentioned that there are some of those tenets, principles that come from Christianity, but have a different flavor, a different interpretation within the context of religious science. Might you comment on what some of those are and what those differences are?
Well, let me just start it off here, because I know they're bursting with something, but the difference is we don't worship the man, we follow his teaching, or we try to.
Mm-hmm.
And so we don't feel it necessary to do a whole lot of interpretation to make what he said fit what I believe.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the greatest teacher of them all, obviously, as far as I'm concerned anyway, mm-hmm. when he said something, we better look straight at it and see what he was saying there, and let that become a truth to us, rather than have to bend it to fit. I suppose everybody does that, and we probably do too, but I think we do very little of it.
Do you work with the Bible much in your work, or what texts, what main scriptures do you work with? Where do you derive sort of leading and guidance in as you work religiously?
Our basic philosophy, our basic underlying philosophy, comes from a book written by our founder, Ernest Holmes, called The Science of Mind.
Mm-hmm.
And if you read that, it's quite a book. In fact, it was on there.
In the picture when we first started.
Yes. Mm-hmm. It you'll find in it Buddhism, Hinduism, Confucianism. You'll find Bible. You'll find quotations. He said we read every man's Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And we glean our truths from every man's belief. And he said, he looked for a day when he could find a group of people that were against nothing and for something.
Mm-hmm.
And we try to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So wherever you find a truth, such as when we mentioned a minute ago when Jesus said that you're going to sow, you're going to reap what you sow.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we spiritualized that sometimes until we got real crazy with it.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we realize that that's what the man said, and that what you sow, you are going to get back?
Simply and straightforward.
Yeah.
Yeah. Interesting. Let's take a brief break from our conversation here, and let me share with our viewing audience, those of you who have gotten your papers and pencils ready, if you have any questions for either our staff here at Spiritual Spectrum or questions about the Church of Religious Science in particular, you might want to note down this address and this telephone number. The address you might write to is Spiritual Spectrum, 2351 Ogden Street, Denver, Colorado, 80205. And the phone number, as you can see on your screen, is area code 303-861-1186. So if you have any questions, either on the show in general or in relation to the church, please do get in touch with us. Interesting. We were talking a little bit about Ernest Holmes and his initial writing of the book. What's the name of the book?
Science of Mind.
Science of Mind. Maybe you could share with us a little bit about the history of religious science. It started with Ernest Holmes, which was when? Back in
1927
is when he wrote the book and began activities.
He actually wrote the book in 1928. Mm-hmm. And he began teaching these principles from, I think, 1916 or 17, mm-hmm. when he began to lecture.
Well, was he did he have a professional status of some kind?
He was a lecturer. He was initially ordained as a minister.
I see.
In another denomination.
I see.
Divine Science, I guess I could say that here.
Uh-huh. That's a good name.
It's a good name. And he was ordained as a minister in that denomination, mm-hmm. prior to starting Religious Science.
Mm-hmm. So then he was lecturing, and then people would come listen to his talks.
In Los Angeles, he lectured at the Wiltern Theater to thousands of people every Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
And out of that, a group of businessmen got together and decided to form an organization around his teaching. And they called it the Institute of Religious Science and School of Philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
And that was in 1927. And it began to grow and unfold, and he was teaching classes. His desire was to take the philosophy and teach it to ministers, teach it to clergy, so that they could take the philosophy into their own churches,
mm-hmm.
and enhance their theology, enhance their religion.
Within the different denominations.
Yes.
And sort of grew from there.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Very interesting. Let me ask you one last question. I'll maybe ask each one of you to just share a very brief thought, just a few seconds. If our viewers were to go to a Church of Religious Science and participate in the services there, get to know people and join, what in your mind would be the single greatest benefit that they would derive by being a participant in the Church of Religious Science? What single thing would they most benefit from?
I hear it often from people who come to the church, and it was true for myself as well, is that you walk away with a positive attitude. You walk away feeling like you're okay with and confident in yourself, and it's a positive approach to living. You may be working on yourself spiritually, but you walk away rather than feeling a lot of guilt about all the things that you've done wrong. You walk away feeling like uplifted, like, oh, okay, I'm part of the whole. That presence is within. I'm a chip off the old block, if you would, and I'm going to go out there and make this day the best day of my life.
So the one thing that they might most derive, gain benefit from, is a sense of being unified and positive
in their
approach.
Mm-hmm.
I'm afraid we've run out of time, so we'll have to perhaps have another show and look at your thoughts on what they might most benefit from.
So many things I wanted to
say. Patience, Faith. I'd like to thank our guests for being on Spiritual Spectrum and our audience for your stimulating questions, and you, our viewers, for your time and attention. And if you enjoyed this program, please do tune in to our next show, when Spiritual Spectrum will take a look at another new emerging religious group and the personal experience of some of its participants. I'm Marvin Gowron. Thank you.